Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of The Mutiny on Board the H.M.S. Bounty by William Bligh, narrated by Norman Dietz. This recording is copyrighted 1987 by Recorded Books, Incorporated. In April of 1789, the crew of the H.M.S. Bounty mutinied against their captain, William Bligh, intending to return to the island paradise of Tahiti rather than return to the West Indies with the shipment of breadfruit plants that their captain had been commissioned to procure. It's a well-known story, but for the captain and the members of the crew that remained loyal, the drama did not end there. Cast adrift in an open boat, the much-maligned Captain Bligh managed to navigate an amazing 3,600-mile voyage, keeping his crew alive on little to no food, and after crossing much of the South Pacific in 2 months, bring them to safety on the Dutch island colony of Timor, north of Australia. After returning to England, Bligh was able to bring many of the mutineers to ultimate justice. This is Bligh's own account of that voyage, written soon after his return, and beginning in October 1787 with the Bounty's departure from England. And now, the mutiny on board the HMS Bounty.
At the time I published the narrative of the mutiny on board the Bounty, it was my intention that the preceding part of the voyage should be contained in a separate account. This method I have since been induced to alter. The reason of the narrative appearing first was for the purpose of communicating early information concerning an event which had attracted the public notice, and being drawn up in a hasty manner, it required many corrections. Some circumstances, likewise, were omitted, and the notation of time used in the narrative, being according to sea reckoning, in which the days begin and end at noon, must have produced a degree of obscurity and confusion to readers accustomed only to the civil mode. And this would have increased as the remainder of the voyage, on account of the numerous shore occurrences at Otaheite and elsewhere, could not with clearness and propriety have been related in any other than the usual manner of reckoning. Besides remedying these inconveniences, I have thought a fuller account of our passage from Timor to Europe than that contained in the narrative would not be unacceptable. These reasons, with the manifest convenience of comprising the whole voyage in one continued narrative, in preference to letting it appear in disjointed accounts, will, it is hoped, be allowed a sufficient excuse for having varied from the original intention. Nevertheless, for the accommodation of the purchasers of the narrative already published, those who desire it will be supplied with other parts of the voyage separate, that is, the part previous to the mutiny and the additional account after leaving Timor. Chapter 1. Plan of the expedition. Outfit and occurrences to the time of leaving England. Description of the breadfruit. The king, having been graciously pleased to comply with a request from the merchants and planters interested in His Majesty's West India possessions, that the breadfruit tree might be introduced into those islands, a vessel proper for the undertaking was bought and taken into dock at Deptford, to be provided with the necessary fixtures and preparations for executing the object of the voyage. These were completed according to a plan of my much-honored friend Sir Joseph Banks, which, in the event, proved the most advantageous that could have been adopted for the intended purpose. The ship was named the Bounty. I was appointed to command her on the 16th of August, 1787. Her burthen was nearly 215 tons. Her extreme length on deck, 90 feet 10 inches. Extreme breadth, 24 feet 3 inches. And height in the hold under the beams at the main hatchway, 10 feet 3 inches. In the cockpit were the cabins of the surgeon, gunner, botanist, and clerk, with a steward room and storerooms. The between decks was divided in the following manner. The great cabin was appropriated for the preservation of the plants, and extended as far forward as the after hatchway. It had two large skylights, and on each side three scuttles for air, and was fitted with a false floor cut full of holes to contain the garden pots, in which the plants were to be brought home. The deck was covered with lead, and at the foremost corners of the cabin were fixed pipes to carry off the water that drained from the plants into tubs placed below to save it for future use. I had a small cabin on one side to sleep in, adjoining to the great cabin, and a place near the middle of the ship to eat in. The bulkhead of this apartment was at the after part of the main hatchway, and on each side of it were the berths of the mates and midshipmen. Between these berths, the arms chest was placed. The cabin of the master, in which was always kept the key of the arms, was opposite to mine. This particular description of the interior parts of the ship is rendered necessary by the event of the expedition. The ship was masted according to the proportion of the navy, but on my application the masts were shortened, as I thought them too much for her, considering the nature of the voyage. On the 3rd of September the ship came out of dock, but the carpenters and joiners remained on board much longer, as they had a great deal of work to finish. The next material alteration made in the fitting out was lessening the quantity of iron and other ballast. I gave directions that only 19 tons of iron should be taken on board instead of the customary proportion, which was 45 tons. The stores and provisions I judged would be fully sufficient to answer the purpose of the remainder, for I am of the opinion that many of the misfortunes which attend ships in heavy storms of wind are occasioned by too much dead weight in their bottoms. The establishment of men and officers for the ship were as follows: one lieutenant to command, one master, one boatswain, one gunner, one carpenter, one surgeon, two master's mates, two midshipmen, two quartermasters, one quartermaster's mate, one boatswain's mate, one gunner's mate, one carpenter's mate, one carpenter's crew, one sailmaker, one armorer, one corporal, one clerk and steward, 23 able seamen, for a total of 44. Two skillful and careful men were appointed, at Sir Joseph Banks' recommendation, to have the management of the plants intended to be brought home. The one, David Nelson, who had been on similar employment in Captain Cook's last voyage. The other, William Brown, as an assistant to him. With these two, our whole number amounted to 46. It was proposed that our route to the Society Islands should be round Cape Horn, and the greatest dispatch became necessary, as the season was already far advanced. But the shipwrights, not being able to complete their work by the time the ship was ready in other respects, our sailing was unavoidably retarded. However, by the 4th of October, the pilot came on board to take us down the river. On the 9th, we fell down to Long Reach, where we received our gunner's stores and guns, 4 four-pounders and 10 swivels. The ship was stored and victualled for 18 months. In addition to the customary allowance of provisions, we were supplied with sauerkraut, portable soup, essence of malt, dried malt, and a proportion of barley and wheat in lieu of oatmeal. I was likewise furnished with a quantity of ironwork and trinkets to serve in our intercourse with the natives in the South Seas. And from the Board of Longitude I received a timekeeper made by Mr. Kendall. On the 15th I received orders to proceed to Spithead, but the winds and weather were so unfavorable that we did not arrive there till the 4th of November. On the 24th I received from Lord Hood, who commanded at Spithead, my final orders. The wind, which for several days before had been favorable, was now turned directly against us. On the 28th, the ship's company received 2 months' pay in advance, and on the following morning we worked out to St. Helens, where we were obliged to anchor. We made different unsuccessful attempts to get down channel, but contrary winds and bad weather constantly forced us back to St. Helens, or Spithead, until Sunday the 23rd of December, when we sailed with a fair wind. During our stay at Spithead, the rate of the timepiece was several times examined by Mr. Bailey's observations at the Portsmouth Observatory. On the 19th of December, the last time of its being examined on shore, it was 1 minute 52 seconds, 5 too fast for mean time, and then losing at the rate of 1 second, one per day. And at this rate, I estimate it's going when we sailed. The object of all the former voyages to the South Seas, undertaken by the command of His Present Majesty, has been the advancement of science and the increase of knowledge. This voyage may be reckoned the first, the intention of which has been to derive benefit from those distant discoveries. For the more fully comprehending the nature and plan of the expedition, and that the reader may be possessed of every information necessary for entering on the following sheets, I shall here lay before him a copy of the instructions I received from the Admiralty, and likewise a short description of the breadfruit. By the Commissioners for Executing the Office of Lord High Admiral of Great Britain and Ireland, etc. Whereas the King, upon a representation from the merchants and planters interested in His Majesty's West India possessions, that the introduction of the breadfruit trees into the islands of those seas to constitute an article of food would be of very essential benefit to the inhabitants, hath, in order to promote the interests of so respectable a body of his subjects, especially in an instance which promises great advantage, thought fit that measures should be taken for the procuring some of those trees and conveying them to the said West India Islands. And whereas the vessel under your command hath, in consequence thereof, been stored and victualled for that service, and fitted with proper conveniences and necessaries for the preservation of as many of the said trees as from her size can be taken on board her, and you have been directed to receive on board the two gardeners, David Nelson and William Brown, who from their knowledge of trees and plants have been hired for the purpose of selecting such as shall appear to be of a proper species and size, you are, therefore, in pursuance of His Majesty's pleasure, signified to us by Lord Sidney, one of his principal secretaries of state, hereby required and directed to put to sea in the vessel you command, the first favorable opportunity of wind and weather, and proceed with her, as expeditiously as possible, round Cape Horn to the Society Islands, situate in the Southern Ocean, in the latitude of about 18 degrees south, and longitude of about 210 degrees east from Greenwich, where, according to the accounts given by the late Captain Cook and persons who accompanied him during his voyages, the breadfruit tree is to be found in the most luxuriant state. Having arrived at the above-mentioned islands, and taken on board as many trees and plants as may be thought necessary, the better to enable you to do which, you have already been furnished with such articles of merchandise and trinkets as it is supposed will be wanted to satisfy the natives, you are to proceed from thence through Endeavour Straits, which separate New Holland from New Guinea, to Prince's Island in the Straits of Sunda, or, if it should happen to be more convenient, to pass on the eastern side of Java to some port on the north side of that island, where any breadfruit trees which may have been injured or have died may be replaced by mangosteens, durians, jacks, nankas, lances, and other fine fruit trees of that quarter, as well as the rice plant which grows upon dry land. All of which species, or such of them as shall be judged most eligible, you are to purchase on the best terms you can from the inhabitants of that island, with the ducats with which you have also been furnished for that purpose. Taking care, however, if the rice plants above mentioned cannot be procured at Java, to touch at Prince's Island for them, where they are regularly cultivated. From Prince's Island, or the island of Java, you are to proceed round the Cape of Good Hope to the West Indies, calling on your way thither at any places which may be thought necessary, and deposit one half of such of the above-mentioned trees and plants as may be then alive at His Majesty's Botanical Garden at St. Vincent, for the benefit of the Windward Islands, and then go on to Jamaica, and having delivered the remainder to Mr. East, or such person or persons as may be authorized by the governor and council of that island to receive them, refreshed your people, and received on board such provisions and stores as may be necessary for the voyage, make the best of your way back to England, repairing to Spithead and sending to our secretary an account of your arrival and proceedings. And whereas you will receive herewith a copy of the instructions which have been given to the above-mentioned gardeners for their guidance, as well in procuring the said trees and plants, and the management of them after they shall be put on board, as for bringing to England a small sample of each species, and such others as may be prepared by the superintendent of the botanical garden at St. Vincent's, and by the said Mr. East, or others, for His Majesty's garden at Kew, you are hereby required and directed to afford and to give directions to your officers and company to afford the said gardeners every possible aid and assistance, not only in the collecting of the said trees and plants at the places before mentioned, but for their preservation during their conveyance to the places of their destination. Given under our hands the 20th November, 1787. How? Charles Brett, Richard Hopkins, J. Levson Gower. To Lieutenant William Bligh, commanding His Majesty's armed vessel, the Bounty, at Spithead. By Commander of Their Lordships, P. Stevens. In the foregoing orders, it is to be observed that I was particularly directed to proceed round Cape Horn. But as the season was so far advanced, and we were so long detained by contrary winds, I made application to the Admiralty for discretional orders on that point, to which I received the following answer. By the Commissioners for executing the office of Lord High Admiral of Great Britain and Ireland, etc., etc. The season of the year being now so far advanced as to render it probable that your arrival with the vessel you command on the southern coast of America will be too late for your passing round Cape Horn without much difficulty and hazard, you are, in that case, at liberty, notwithstanding former orders, to proceed in her to Otaheite round the Cape of Good Hope. Given under our hands the 18th December, 1787. How? Charles Brett, Bayham. To Lieutenant William Bligh, commanding His Majesty's armed vessel Bounty, Spithead, by command of their lordships, P. Stevens. The breadfruit is so well known and described that to attempt a new account of it would be unnecessary and useless. However, as it may contribute to the convenience of the reader, I have given the following extracts respecting it. Extract from the account of Dampier's voyage round the world, performed in 1688. The breadfruit, as we call it, grows on a large tree, as big and high as our largest apple trees. It hath a spreading head, full of branches and dark leaves. The fruit grows on the boughs like apples. It is as big as a penny loaf, when wheat is at 5 shillings the bushel. It is of a round shape, and hath a thick, tough rind. When the fruit is ripe, it is yellow and soft, and the taste is sweet and pleasant. The natives of Guam use it for bread. They gather it when full grown, while it is green and hard. Then they bake it in an oven, which scorcheth the rind and makes it black. But they scrape off the outside black crust, and there remains a tender, thin crust. And the inside is soft, tender, and white, like the crumb of a penny loaf. There is neither seed nor stone in the inside, but all is of a pure substance, like bread. It must be eaten new, for if it is kept above 24 hours, it grows harsh and choky. But it is very pleasant before it is too stale. This fruit lasts in season 8 months in the year, during which the natives eat no other sort of food of bread kind. I did never see of this fruit anywhere but here. The natives told us that there is plenty of this fruit growing on the rest of the Ladrone Islands, and I never did hear of it anywhere else. Extract from the account of Lord Anson's voyage, published by Mr. Walter. There was, at Tinian, a kind of fruit peculiar to these Ladrone Islands, called by the Indians rime, but by us the breadfruit. For it was constantly eaten by us during our 2 month stay upon the island, instead of bread. And so universally preferred that no ship's bread was expended in that whole interval. It grew upon a tree which is somewhat lofty, and which, towards the top, divides into huge spreading branches. The leaves of this tree are of a remarkable deep green, are notched about the edges, and are generally from a foot to 18 inches in length. The fruit itself is found indifferently on all parts of the branches. It is, in shape, rather elliptical than round. It is covered with a tough rind and is usually 7 or 8 inches long. Each of them grows singly and not in clusters. This fruit is the fittest to be used when it is full grown, but still green, in which state, after it is properly prepared by being roasted in the embers, its taste has some distant resemblance to that of an artichoke's bottom, and its texture is not very different, for it is soft and spongy. Extracts from the account of the first voyage of Captain Cook, Hawksworth, Volume 2. The breadfruit grows on a tree that is about the size of a middling oak. Its leaves are frequently a foot and a half long, of an oblong shape, deeply sinuated like those of a fig tree, which they resemble in consistence and color, and in the exuding of a white milky juice upon being broken. The fruit is about the size and shape of a child's head, and the surface is reticulated not much unlike a truffle. It is covered with a thin skin and has a core about as big as the handle of a small knife. The eatable part lies between the skin and the core. It is as white as snow and somewhat of the consistence of new bread. It must be roasted before it is eaten, being first divided into 3 or 4 parts. Its taste is insipid, with a slight sweetness, somewhat resembling that of the crumb of wheaten bread mixed with a Jerusalem artichoke. Of the many vegetables that have been mentioned already, as serving them for food, the principal is the breadfruit, to procure which costs them no trouble or labor but climbing a tree. The tree which produces it does not indeed shoot up spontaneously, but if a man plants 10 of them in his lifetime, which he may do in about an hour, he will as completely fulfill his duty to his own and future generations as the native of our less temperate climate can do by plowing in the cold winter and reaping in the summer's heat as often as these seasons return. Even if, after he has procured bread for his present household, he should convert a surplus into money and lay it up for his children. It is true, indeed, that the breadfruit is not always in season, but coconuts, bananas, plantains, and a great variety of other fruits supply the deficiency. Extract from the account of Captain Cook's last voyage. In the Society Islands. I, Captain Cook, have inquired very carefully into their manner of cultivating the breadfruit tree at Otaheite, but was always answered that they never planted it. This indeed must be evident to everyone who will examine the places where the young trees come up. It will be always observed that they spring from roots of the old ones, which run along near the surface of the ground, so that the breadfruit trees may be reckoned those that would naturally cover the plains, even supposing that the island was not inhabited. In the same manner that the white-barked trees found at Van Diemen's Land constitute the forests there. And from this we may observe that the inhabitant of Otaheite, instead of being obliged to plant his bread, will rather be under the necessity of preventing its progress, which, I suppose, is sometimes done, to give room for trees of another sort, to afford him some variety in his food. In the Sandwich Islands. The breadfruit trees are planted and flourish with great luxuriance on rising grounds, where the hills rise almost perpendicularly in a great variety of peaked forms. Their steep sides and the deep chasms between them are covered with trees, amongst which those of the breadfruit were observed particularly to abound. The climate of the Sandwich Islands differs very little from that of the West India Islands, which lie in the same latitude, Upon the whole, perhaps, it may be rather more temperate. The breadfruit trees thrive in these islands, not in such abundance, but produce double the quantity of fruit they do on the rich plains of Otaheite. The trees are nearly of the same height, but the branches begin to strike out from the trunk much lower and with greater luxuriance. Chapter 2. Departure from England. Arrival at Tenerife. Sail from thence. Arrival off Cape Horn. Severity of the weather. Obliged to bear away for the Cape of Good Hope. On Sunday morning, the 23rd of December, 1787, we sailed from Spithead, and passing through the Needles, directed our course down channel with a fresh gale of wind at east. In the afternoon, one of the seamen, in furling the main topgallant sail, fell off the yard and was so fortunate as to save himself by catching hold of the main topmast stay in his fall. At night, the wind increased to a strong gale, with a heavy sea. It moderated, however, on the 25th and allowed us to keep our Christmas with cheerfulness. But the following day it blew a severe storm of wind from the eastward, which continued until the 29th, in the course of which we suffered greatly. One sea broke away the spare yards and spars out of the starboard main chains. Another heavy sea broke into the ship and stove all the boats. Several casks of beer that had been lashed upon deck were broke loose and washed overboard. And it was not without great difficulty and risk that we were able to secure the boats from being washed away entirely. On the 29th, we were in latitude 39 degrees 35 minutes north and longitude 14 degrees 26 minutes west when the gale abated and the weather became fair. Besides other mischief done to us by the storm, a large quantity of our bread was damaged and rendered useless, for the sea had stove in our stern and filled the cabin with water. From this time to our arrival at Tenerife, we had moderate weather and winds mostly from the northward. January 4th. This forenoon we spoke a French ship bound to the Mauritius. The next day at 9 in the forenoon we saw the island of Tenerife, bearing west-southwest, one-half west, about 12 leagues distant. It was covered with a thick haze, except the northwesternmost part, which is a remarkable headland, resembling a horse's head, the ears very distinct. To the eastward of this head, south 82 degrees east by the compass, lie two round rocks, the northern boundary of Tenerife. I had a good observation at noon, by which I make the latitude of the two rocks 28 degrees 44 minutes north, and their longitude by our timekeeper 16 degrees 5 minutes west. To the southward of these, and near the shore, is a high needle rock. About 4 leagues farther to the southward, the coast inclines towards the west, to the road of Santa Cruz, where we anchored at 9:30 on Sunday morning in 25 fathoms water, and moored along the shore in the same depth, with the cupola tower of the Church of St. Francis bearing west 1/2 north 1 mile, the east part of the road east by north, the castle on the south point, southwest, and the west part of the Grand Canary, south-southeast. A Spanish packet bound to Corunna, an American brig, and several other vessels were lying there. As soon as the ship was anchored, I sent an officer, Mr. Christian, to wait on the governor and to acquaint him I had put in to obtain refreshments and to repair the damages we had sustained in bad weather. To this I had a very polite answer from the governor, Marquis de Branchforte, that I should be supplied with whatever the island afforded. I had also directed the officer to acquaint him that I would salute, provided an equal number of guns were to be returned. But as I received an extraordinary answer to this part of my message, purporting that His Excellency did not return the same number but to persons equal in rank to himself, this ceremony was omitted. During this interval I was visited by the portmaster, Captain Adams, and shortly afterwards several officers came on board from His Excellency to compliment me on my arrival. As soon as the ship was moored, I went on shore and paid my respects to him. On Monday morning, I began to forward the ship's business with the utmost dispatch, and gave the necessary directions to Messrs. Culligan and Sons, the contractors, for the supplies I wanted. I also got leave of the governor for Mr. Nelson to range the hills and examine the country in search of plants and natural curiosities. As there was a great surf on the shore, I bargained for everything I wanted to be brought off by the shore boats, and agreed to give 5 shillings per ton for water. Very good wine was bought at £10 per pipe, the contract price, but the superior quality was £15, and some of this was not much inferior to the best London Madeira. I found this was an unfavorable season for other refreshments. Indian corn, potatoes, pumpkins, and onions were all very scarce, and double the price of what they are in summer. Beef also was difficult to be procured, and exceedingly poor, the price nearly 6 pence farthing per pound. The corn was 3 current dollars per fanego, which is full 5 shillings per bushel, and biscuit at 25 shillings for 100 pounds. Poultry was so scarce that a good fowl cost 3 shillings. This is, therefore, not a place for ships to expect refreshments at a reasonable price at this time of the year, wine excepted. But from March to November, supplies are plentiful, particularly fruit, of which at this time we could procure none except a few dried figs and some bad oranges. During our stay here, the weather was fair, with northeast winds and calms, and small drizzling rain in the night. The thermometer from 66 degrees to 69 degrees at noon in the shade. I could make no lunar observations for the longitude, but by the help of the timekeeper I have computed the situation of the town of Santa Cruz to be 28 degrees 28 minutes north latitude and 16 degrees 18 minutes west longitude. I observed the variation by 2 compasses to be 20 degrees 1 minute west. This much exceeded what I would have imagined, for in 1776 I observed it only 14 degrees 40 minutes west, a difference of above 5 degrees in 11 years, and this makes me reflect on the uncertainty of obtaining the exact deviation of the magnetic pole, and of course its annual variation, which never can be accurately ascertained unless the observations are made always in one spot and with the same compass. Tenerife, though considerably without the tropic, is so nearly within the limits of the trade wind that navigators generally steer to it from the eastward. The road of Santa Cruz lies on the east side of the island, at the end of a range of craggy hills, barren and very lofty, along which you sail west by south by compass into the road, with the sea unfathomable until near the shore. The anchoring ground may be accounted from 50 fathoms to 20, or even 15. The bank is very steep and gives but little time to sound, for which reason it should be done effectually with a heavy lead, or a ship will be too near in before a stranger is aware of it. He will likewise too soon expect to find bottom, owing to the great deception of the adjacent high land. To obviate these difficulties, it is necessary to observe that while a town which lies some distance to the southward of Santa Cruz is open with the castle on the south part of the road, though you may appear near the shore, there is no anchorage. But after it is entirely shut in, you get on the bank. The church bearing west or west by south, and the south point of the road southwest 1/2 south to southwest by west, is a good situation for anchoring. The depth about 25 fathoms. The distance from the shore will be 3/4 of a mile, and the southernmost land that can be seen then will be 1/2 or 1/4 point of the compass farther out than the south point of the road. The bottom is black, soft mud with some patches of rocks, for which reason vessels that lie here any length of time buoy their cables. This precaution, besides being useful in that particular, they think makes them ride more easy when there is much sea setting into the road, which, with the wind anyway to the southward of east or at southwest, must be very considerable. It is, therefore, usual to moor with 4 anchors, though more than 2 are scarce ever of use. Mooring is, however, advisable if a ship is only to remain 24 hours, and the tighter the better, that the cables may keep clear of the ground. The landing on the beach is generally impracticable with our own boats, at least without great risk. But there is a fine pier on which people may land without difficulty if there is not much swell in the road. To this pier the water is conveyed by pipes for the use of shipping, and for which all merchant ships pay. There is a degree of wretchedness and want among the lower class of people, which is not anywhere so common as among the Spanish and Portuguese settlements. To alleviate these evils, the present governor of Tenerife has instituted a most charitable society, which he takes the trouble to superintend, and by considerable contributions, a large airy dwelling that contains 120 poor girls and as many men and boys has been built, and endowed with a sufficiency of land round it, not only for all present purposes, but for enlarging the building for more object of charity as their funds increase. I had the honor to be shown by His Excellency this asylum, hospicio they call it, where there appeared in every countenance the utmost cheerfulness and content. The decency and neatness of the dress of the young females, with the order in which they were arranged at their spinning wheels and looms, in an extensive, airy apartment, was admirable. A governess inspected and regulated all their works, which were the manufacturing of ribbons of all colors, coarse linens, and tapes, all which were managed and brought to perfection by themselves, from the silk and flax in their first state. Even the dyeing of the colors is performed by them. These girls are received for 5 years, at the end of which they are at liberty to marry, and have for their portions their wheel and loom, with a sum of money proportioned to the state of the fund, which is assisted by the produce of their labor, and at this time was estimated at $2,000 per annum. The men and boys are not less attended to. They are employed in coarser work, blanketing, and all kinds of common woolens. If they become infirm, they spend the remainder of their days here comfortably, and under a watchful inspector who attends them in the same manner as the governess does the girls. They are all visited every day by the governor, and a clergyman attends them every evening. By this humane institution, a number of people are rendered useful and industrious in a country where the poor, from the indulgence of the climate, are too apt to prefer a life of inactivity, though attended with wretchedness, to obtaining the comforts of life by industry and labor. The number of inhabitants in the island, I was informed, were estimated at between 80 and 100,000. Their annual export of wine is 20,000 pipes, and of brandy, half that quantity. Vessels are frequently here from St. Eustatia, and from thence a great quantity of Tenerife wine is carried to the different parts of the West Indies under the name of Madeira. Tenerife is considered of more value than all the other Canaries. The inhabitants, however, in scarce seasons, receive supplies from the Grand Canary, but their vineyards here are said to be greatly superior. Their produce of corn, though exceedingly good, is not sufficient for their consumption, and, owing to this, the Americans have an advantageous trade here for their flour and grain, and take wine in return. The town of Santa Cruz is about half a mile in extent each way, built in a regular manner, and the houses in general large and airy, but the streets are very ill-paved. I am told that they are subject to few diseases, but if any epidemic distemper breaks out, it is attended with the most fatal consequences, particularly the smallpox, the bad effects of which they now endeavor to counteract by inoculation. For this reason, they are very circumspect in admitting ships to have communication with the shore without bills of health. A sloop from London, called the Chance, William Meredith, master, bound to Barbados, out 19 days from the Downs, came into the road the day before we sailed. She had suffered much by the bad weather, but having brought no bill of health, the governor would not allow any person to come on shore unless I could vouch for them that no epidemic disease raged in England at the time they sailed, which I was able to do, it being nearly at the same time that I left the land. And by that means, they had the governor's permission to receive the supplies they wanted, without being obliged to perform quarantine. Having finished our business at Tenerife, on Thursday the 10th, we sailed with the wind at southeast, our ship's company all in good health and spirits. I now divided the people into three watches and gave the charge of the third watch to Mr. Fletcher Christian, one of the mates. I have always considered this as a desirable regulation when circumstances will admit of it, on many accounts, and am persuaded that unbroken rest not only contributes much towards the health of a ship's company, but enables them more readily to exert themselves in cases of sudden emergency. As it was my wish to proceed to Otaheite without stopping, I ordered everybody to be at 2/3 allowance of bread. I also directed the water for drinking to be filtered through dripstones that I had bought at Tenerife for that purpose. In the evening, we passed the south end of Tenerife, which is a round lump of land that, from the lowness of the contiguous land, has at a distance the appearance of a separate island. By our run from the Bay of Santa Cruz, I make the latitude of the south end of Tenerife to be 28 degrees 6 minutes north. We ran all night towards the south-southwest, having the wind at southeast. The next morning, we could see nothing of the land. I now made the ship's company acquainted with the intent of the voyage. And having been permitted to hold out this encouragement to them, I gave assurances of the certainty of promotion to everyone whose endeavors should merit it. The winds, for some days after leaving Tenerife, were mostly from the southward. Fishing lines and tackle were distributed amongst the people, and some dolphins were caught. On the 17th January, the wind came round to the northeast and continued steady in that quarter till the 25th, on which day, at noon, we were in 3 degrees 54 minutes north. As the cloudiness of the sky gave us reason to expect much rain, we prepared the awnings with hoses for the convenience of saving water, in which we were not disappointed. From this time to our meeting with the southeast trade wind, we had much wet weather, the air close and sultry, with calms and light variable winds, generally from the southward. On the 29th, there was so heavy a fall of rain that we caught 700 gallons of water. On the 31st, latitude at noon, 2 degrees 5 minutes north, found a current setting to the northeast at the rate of 14 miles in the 24 hours. The thermometer was at 82 degrees in the shade, and at 81.5 at the surface of the sea, so that the air and the water were within half a degree of the same temperature. At 8 o'clock in the evening, we observed a violent rippling in the sea, about half a mile to the northwest of us, which had very much the appearance of breakers. This I imagine to have been occasioned by a large school or multitude of fish, as it was exactly in the track the ship had passed, so that if any real shoal had been there, we must have seen it at the close of the evening, when a careful lookout was always kept. However, if it had appeared ahead of us instead of astern, I should certainly have tacked to avoid it. To such appearances I attribute the accounts of many shoals within the tropics, which cannot be found anywhere but in maps. Our latitude at this time was 2 degrees 8 minutes north, and longitude 19 degrees 43 minutes west. The next day we had more of these appearances from the number of schools of fish by which the ship was surrounded. Saturday, the 2nd February. This morning we saw a sail to the north-northwest, but at too great a distance to distinguish what she was. Monday, the 4th, had very heavy rain, during which we nearly filled all our empty water casks. So much wet weather, with the closeness of the air, covered everything with mildew. The ship was aired below with fires and frequently sprinkled with vinegar, and every little interval of dry weather was taken advantage of to open all the hatchways and clean the ship, and to have all the people's wet things washed and dried. With this weather and light, unsteady winds, we advanced but 2.5 degrees in 12 days, at the end of which time we were relieved by the southeast trade wind, which we fell in with on the 6th at noon in latitude 1 degree 21 minutes north and longitude 20 degrees 42 minutes west. The weather became fine, and the southeast trade wind was fresh and steady, with which we kept a point free from the wind and got to the southward at a good rate. The weather continuing dry, we put some of our bread in casks, properly prepared for its reception, to preserve it from vermin. This experiment, we afterwards found, answered exceedingly well. On the 16th, at daylight, we saw a sail to the southward. The next day we came up with her and found her to be the British Queen, Simon Paul, master, from London, bound to the Cape of Good Hope, on the whale fishery. She sailed from Falmouth the 5th December, 18 days before I left Spithead. By this ship I wrote to England. At sunset she was almost out of sight astern. Monday the 18th. In the course of this day's run, the variation changed from west to east. According to our observations, the true and magnetic meridians coincided in latitude 20 degrees 0 minutes south and longitude 31 degrees 15 minutes west. At noon, we were in latitude 20 degrees 44 minutes south and longitude 31 degrees 23 minutes west. In our advances toward the south, the wind had gradually veered round to the east and was at this time at east-northeast. The weather, after crossing the line, had been fine and clear, but the air so sultry as to occasion great faintness, the quicksilver in the thermometer in the daytime standing at between 81 and 83 degrees, and one time at 85 degrees. In our passage through the northern tropic, the air was temperate, the sun having then high south declination, and the weather being generally fine till we lost the northeast trade wind. But such a thick haze surrounded the horizon that no object could be seen except at a very small distance. The haze commonly cleared away at sunset and gathered again at sunrise. Between the northeast and southeast trade winds, the calms and rains, if of long continuance, are very liable to produce sickness, unless great attention is paid to keeping the ship clean and wholesome, by giving all the air possible, drying between decks with fires, and drying and airing the people's clothes and bedding. Besides these precautions, we frequently wetted with vinegar, and every evening the pumps were used as ventilators. With these endeavors to secure health, we passed the low latitudes without a single complaint. The currents we met with were by no means regular, nor have I ever found them so in the middle of the ocean. However, from the channel to the southward, as far as Madeira, there is generally a current setting to the south-southeast. On the evening of the 21st, a ship was seen in the northeast, but at too great a distance to distinguish of what country. The next day the wind came round to the north and northwest, so that we could no longer consider ourselves in the trade wind. Our latitude at noon was 25 degrees 55 minutes south, longitude 36 degrees 29 minutes west, variation of the compass 3 degrees east. Saturday the 23rd, towards night, the wind died away, and we had some heavy showers of rain, of which we profited by saving a ton of good water. The next day we caught a shark and 5 dolphins. Tuesday 26th, we bent new sails and made other necessary preparations for encountering the weather that was to be expected in a high latitude. Our latitude at noon was 29 degrees 38 minutes south, longitude 41 degrees 44 minutes west, variation 7 degrees 13 minutes east. In the afternoon, the wind being westerly and blowing strong in squalls, some butterflies and other insects, like what we call horseflies, were blown on board of us. No birds were seen except shearwaters. Our distance from the coast of Brazil at this time was above 100 leagues. Sunday, 2nd March, in the forenoon, after seeing that every person was clean, divine service was performed, according to my usual custom on this day. I gave to Mr. Fletcher, Christian, whom I had before directed to take charge of the third watch, a written order to act as lieutenant. Saturday, 8th. We were at noon in latitude 36 degrees 50 minutes south, and longitude 52 degrees 53 minutes west. The last 4 days we several times tried for soundings without finding bottom, though considerably to the westward of Captain Wallace's track, who had soundings at 54 fathoms depth in latitude 35 degrees 40 minutes south and longitude 49 degrees 54 minutes west. This day we tried with 240 fathoms of line, but did not find bottom. At the same time, observing a rippling in the water, we tried the current by mooring a keg with 100 fathoms of line, by which it appeared to run to the north-northwest at the rate of a mile and a half per hour. By the noon observation, however, we were 18 miles to the southward of our reckoning. In the afternoon we saw a turtle floating, and not having much wind, hoisted a boat out and sent after it. But it was found to be in a putrid state, with a number of crabs feeding upon it. The change of temperature began now to be sensibly felt, there being a variation in the thermometer since yesterday of 8 degrees. That the people might not suffer by their own negligence, I gave orders for their light tropical clothing to be put by, and made them dress in a manner more suited to a cold climate. I had provided for this before I left England by giving directions for such clothes to be purchased as were necessary. Monday, 10th. In the forenoon we struck soundings at 83 fathoms depth, our latitude 40 degrees 8 minutes south, and longitude 55 degrees 40 minutes west. This I conclude to have been near the edge of the bank, for the wind being at south-southwest, we stood towards the southeast, and after running 14 miles in that direction we could find no bottom with 160 fathoms of line. In the night we stood towards the west-southwest with a southerly wind and got again into soundings. The next day we saw a great number of whales of an immense size that had two spout holes on the back of the head. Upon a complaint made to me by the master, I found it necessary to punish Matthew Quintal, one of the seamen, with 24 lashes for insolence and mutinous behavior. Before this I had not occasion to punish any person on board. On the 12th we caught a porpoise by striking it with the grains. Everyone eat heartily of it, and it was so well liked that no part was wasted. On the 14th, in the afternoon, we saw a land bird like a lark, and passed part of a dead whale that had been left by some whalers after they'd taken the blubber off. Saw likewise two strange sail. The next day, at noon, our latitude was 43 degrees 6 minutes south, and longitude 58 degrees 42 minutes west. Had soundings at 75 fathoms. The bottom a fine greenish sand. Saw two hawks. On the 16th, another ship was seen to the west-northwest, standing to the northward. Latitude at noon, 43 degrees 34 minutes south. We continued running to the southward.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.